gentlemen, please welcome our next speaker, Mr. Aniruddha Khekale, Group Director, HR, Emerson Process Management India. Sir, may I request you to please come on the stage?
Thank you. morning, all.
Good morning, sir.
Okay, sounds good. I have to apologize for one thing. I couldn't really convince them to give you a 5-10 minutes break because I thought you might need that break, but then I'm told, no, you finish your session. So I have a difficult job to keep you here because I'm sure you all are looking forward to little bit of break. But let's see how does it go. We are very flexible. Let's see how does it go. So, as the introduction suggests, my name is Aniruddha Khekale. I work for a company called Emerson. Process management. We are a group of business. We are a US multinational company which has got a presence across the globe, and we operate into the space of process management and power backups and other stuff that we do across the industry space. I belong to a platform called Process Management, which essentially we operate in the oil and gas space. And that's the reason, whatever is happening today in terms of the business, challenging business environment or a counter, whatever way you look at it, we are directly impacted with that. So, earlier session was quite fascinating. I like the world of advertising and marketing and branding and how do you influence consumer behavior and all of that. Very exciting session. My session is relatively boring. We are going to talk about downturn and all of that, right? So, but be with me. I will just like to share some experience that we have gone through and how does it really help you to manage to downturn. So let me try and do that a little bit. I would like to take more of questions than really talking, from my standpoint. So let's go through this. Okay. So when we talk about challenging business environment, and we talk about VUCA, we talk about many things today. Is it something really new? Is it something really new to us? No? So world around us has been changing, right? World around us has been changing. If you really look at your grandparents, what a change in their life? What a change in their life? If you look at their active lifespan, what has changed? What changes they may have seen in their active period?
Environment.
Huh?
Technology.
What a change in technology space in their world?
Internet.
Pardon, maybe, yeah. What a change in their world? No, so I'm not talking about today. Just in their, assume that they had their 35, 40 years active professional life or work related life. What changed during that period?
Communication channel.
I have also changed.
Correct.
If I have to say, the things, the norms have also changed, the rules of the games have also changed.
Okay. No, but materialistically, what changed? Let's say, for example, there used to be a radio, but perhaps they started seeing a television, right? Watching a television. That has changed. What else has changed? Transportation, what has changed?
Medium
of? Okay. What else? Okay, so let's look at it this way because I'm finding it difficult to connect to many voices that are coming. Pardon? Technology. Right, so technology has been changing ever. But in their space, what has really changed? That a radio becomes a smaller radio and then, pardon? Communication, right? So they hardly had any means to communicate and they had to write letters. And at some point of time they started seeing a instrument called telephone which would work only one day in a month, probably, and very difficult to connect to the other side. But only that would change. If you look at the change, amount of change that happened in those days was very minimal. Maybe they had little better means of transportation, a motor vehicle started coming in and all of that. Correct? Right?
Yes, sir.
If you look at our parents, compared to these 3-4 major changes in our grandparents' life, how many changes? Let's not get into the what changed. But how many changes must have happened in our parents' life? Quite a few, right? Quite a few. Things started changing, their ways of connecting with the world, socialization started happening. Many things many things change. What has changed in our world? What has changed in our world? Okay, I'll just give you a real life example of my own example. I got my first mobile phone, you know, when I was perhaps in 30s. Right? When I was in 30s. That too, I was given with by, given, first mobile phone was given by my company because I was holding some kind of position and I took a lot of pride and I used to flash it, you know, wherever I used to go. That was my, you know, time. My daughter got it when she was perhaps 16, 17. My son got it when he's at 9 and 10. And he's already talking about, you know, iPhone busy when he's right now 14. Right? Things are up because, and why? It's not because we can afford, it's because we need it. My daughter's everything, her studies, everything that happens over either WhatsApp or you know, through a mobile phone. And they have everything stored in the cloud. My son is connected to his world only through a mobile phone, with parents, with everyone around. Right? So things are changing, definitely changing, but they are changing at a very rapid and a fast pace. Right? Now let's go to the root of it. Why are those things changing around us at a rapid pace? Who is driving that change? We are driving the change. Our needs are changing. Right? Our needs are changing. So we are accelerating the pace of change. Right? So if the world around us is changing, we are responsible for driving that change. Correct? Are you all with me?
Yes, sir.
Right. And then, because of that change, in turn, who gets impacted? We get impacted. Right? So look at the interesting thing, that is phenomena that is happening. So we drive change, we accelerate change, you know, we demand more and more, and we influence industry to change, and that change starts impacting us. And then we say, oh, we are in a challenging environment, we are in a VUCA world. Who created VUCA? We created VUCA. Right? So who has to get out of this VUCA?
We
have to help ourselves to get out of, you know, this particular environment. Alright. So I'm going to bring this entire focus back onto a reality at an organizational level. I'm going to share with you experience of how we managed to, turn around our business situation sometime back and what could typically be done. This is not an answer to a problem. The problem is created by us and that problem is changing as we speak. So we need to try and find answers as we go. But I'll just share that with you. And maybe then we can look at some questions. Right? So what do we do when we are in downturn in a particular segment? What do we really do? And I'm looking for one line answer to this. There's no big philosophy. Pardon?
Find alternatives
to get out of it. Okay. What else? What else? I'll tell you one simple principle that we use. Is we prepare for the upturn. We prepare for the turnaround. We accept things as they are coming in. And then we start working towards what if scenario, when are we going to turn around, we don't know, but then we start preparing for the turnaround to happen. Right? And that goes in, and how does the whole thing work? Let's take a quick look at it. So there are three things that we do. One is we stay anchored in keeping employees in the center. And as a company, what happens is, as 2009 this happened, for us in 2013 this happened, and now again, oil and gas industry for the last couple of years has been facing this. And employee, every day, when they come to work, they come with a question in mind, that will there be a restructuring, right? How this entire slowdown is going to impact me, right? How do I really take care of my family? All of those questions employee, they bring to work when they come to office. What is at the same time company management is thinking? At the same time, company management is thinking, this is temporary. This is temporary. Things are going to change. You know, how can we go close to the customer? How can we really look at their real needs? How can we really be with them in this difficult time? And we still earn our share and we still be, at a service to them. So there are these two thought processes happening at the same time. What do we need to do as a company? We really need to stay anchored with the core that we have in our own business and keeping employees in mind. Keeping in mind that there are thousands of lives that are going to be impacted or touched positively with what's happening around us. That's the first management philosophy that we need to adopt. The second, what we do is retain and engage the core. There is always core in a business. There are always key employees. There are always key management staff members. There are always people, those who are very, very critical for your success. Keep them. Keep them engaged. Keep them busy. And how do we do that? There are some ideas there in my presentation, but essentially, we keep them engaged with a problem. And I go back to a family. Right? Whenever there is a situation in a family, what do?
Communicate.
That's absolutely bang on. And what do we do next? We make them as a part of the whole strategy, right? They are with you. They are with you together. What do we say? That we are together in it. And we are going to solve this problem. And same thing is applicable back in the organization as well. If you go and communicate to your core and say, you are important, and all of us together are going to solve this problem, half the battle is won. Many companies, and I was yesterday morning, I was listening to some panel discussion. Some of them, they said, you know, we give money, we give deferred bonus, we give this, we give that. But that is essentially telling you that, you know, you are still not a part of, the internal core. So that communication and the message is very important. The third, how do we really respond? How does this work? How do you really respond with a human model? And then my next 15-20 minutes presentation is essentially about that. So look at this construct. Look at this construct. There are three elements there. Can somebody read? What is the first?
Moral compass.
Why it is important for any organization when in downturn to look at moral compass? Pardon? They should have their own values. If you are anchored into your value, if you are anchored into your core values, you have a long-term success. Right? Because in downturn, in difficult situation, what is easy to give up is your fundamentals. Right? What is very easy and convenient at that point of time to give up your fundamentals. Let's say you are caught by a traffic police for jumping a signal and you are in a stress. You want to reach somewhere, your girlfriend is waiting for you, your boyfriend is waiting for you. You want to reach there quickly enough, and then this guy is saying, sir, aapne to signal jump kiya. What is convenient at that point of time? You take out a 100-rupee note and show it to the constable and get your way. Right? It's very easy. What is difficult is to stay anchored. But those who stay anchored, there have been many organizations, you know, those who don't give up on their ethics, don't give up on their values. And similarly, companies like Emerson, they've been there for 150 years. How do they, you know, sustain over a period of long term? They're anchored with the moral compass. But they make sure that the business is done, but done in the right way. Right? I think that's the fundamental thing. The second important thing, if you go to the bottom on the right hand side, what is written there? No, so my right hand side is the way I look at it. It's the
focus on results.
Yeah, it's the focus on results. So you, pardon? So it's the focus on results. What does it mean? Is constantly you are improving your productivity. And I will talk about what we did to improve our productivity in our business case. But constantly you improve the productivity. And the third is human and empathy. Don't give away that. And we were talking yesterday again, the same topic about retrenchment and restructuring. And some parts of the world, as you enter into office, you will find that you are not able to log into your system. And you will see a pink slip, please contact HR department. And that's where you get to know that you have been fired. Right? That's one way of looking at it. The other way of looking at it, how can we be human? How can we be sensitive to people, those who work with you for many years? And their positions, job positions may have become redundant, or you may have excess staff. How do we really manage all of that with the human model? So all those three things, if you keep your strategies within this construct, you will definitely be able to come out of that, you know, downturn, however difficult it may be. Right? Okay. Let me walk you through a quick case study that we did sometime back in 2013. We had seen a very difficult downturn. We did very simple things. It's not a great management strategy, but we just did something very simple. So there were three things that generally come to anybody's mind whenever there is a downturn. Most of the companies essentially talk about cost containment. That I have to reduce manpower, I have to save some cost, I have to give some leave furloughs, I have to do wage delays or no increment. All of those kind of things start coming in your mind, and essentially you get challenged for doing a cost containment. That's one thing you can definitely do. Second, you respond to downturn by restructuring. You take 500 people out, you take 5,000 people out, and that's the way you respond to the downturn and you get your cost down. And third, then you enter into a kind of downward spiral. Because you don't have people, you are not able to create the same business leaders. Because you are not able to create the same business leaders, business results, then you are again in the stress. Right? And that starts impacting your organization as a whole. And you don't come to know when you actually enter the downward spiral. Now, how do we really get out of this situation? In 2013, when we were in the similar situation, we said, how do we really get out of this particular mess? And we said, answer to the problem of downturn is not reducing the cost. It is actually growth. It is actually growth. How do we really grow out of this particular problem? Our Asia Pacific president visited India and he said, I want you guys to grow out of this problem. Right? So how do we really grow out of this problem? How do we really achieve this growth? For achieving growth, one simple thing is needed in organization, which is positive energy. You don't want people to feel depressed. You don't want them to feel down, you know, just because there is a restructuring squad. But you want to really create and retain positive energy within the organization. Now, how do we do that? How do we do that? Great leaders, the way they do it, they create hope and direction. They really create a lot of hope. Mahatma Gandhi did the same thing, right? They created hope that we will see a freedom. And then the entire country started moving with them and he could rally around people. So hope and direction. How do we create hope and direction? By giving them? Okay. What else? By giving them authority. Okay. Recognition, motivation. All of these things are great ideas. But the most simple terms, how do we do that? You communicate. My friend sitting there said, communicate. You know, first, and what do you communicate? And there's the next slide on that. What do we really communicate? What do we really communicate?
Ideas.
So when you are in a trouble, what do we really communicate? Should we go back and say, no, things are going to be great, don't worry about anything else.
Analyze and improvise.
Okay. I think ladies sitting there got it right. What you communicate is there is a problem. We are in a problem. Right? And we are going to solve this problem. That's a very simple philosophy. And then you start people looking at you and then they start participating with you. Second is bring their focus. The most important thing, bring their focus on what is critical at that particular moment. What is that they need to do at that particular moment. Third, you engage your core. In my earlier chart I said, you engage your core. You engage your high potential employees. You engage your high performing employees. And fourth, you reorganize. You can reorganize the entire workforce. This is something which we did. I'll give you an example of communication that in May 2013 that my country managing director did to the entire organization. We suddenly started seeing softness in the order. Order rate started going down rapidly. And then we got all people around and then we said, we have a problem. And how he actually presented that problem to people, he named it as a perfect storm. And he said, we are in a perfect storm. So first level of admission by a leader that we are in trouble actually tells people that we have our feet on the ground. We know where we are going wrong. Second, he said, what can we do? And this is the same chart that I picked up from the communication that we did. He says, one way to respond is that we press a panic button. That, we are in trouble. We are in deep shit. We are in a crazy condition. Or you can just freeze. So there is no reaction. When suddenly you see something which is unexpected, your reaction is to freeze. And then he said you can freeze and do not respond, do not act, don't do anything else. Or start running helter and skelter and then keep doing stuff which may not be as useful as it should be for us. So So he did that communication, and then his simple message to the organization was, sorry, something went wrong. His organization, okay, let me see what is happening. Okay, doesn't matter. At least these people are able to see, I am not able to see it there. So he said, either our reaction can be that, or our reaction can be that we can be proactive. What does it mean? There is a stimulus which is coming from the market environment, and we have a freedom to choose what do we want to do and choose our response as well. Right? And then he said, in order to choose a response, you have to be self-aware, you need to use your imagination, you need to use your independent will and conscious very, very well so that you can choose a right response to the whole thing. So it sounds a little complicated, it sounds a little philosophical. What we actually did, we used a very simple, very, very simple mechanism to really get everybody back onto the focus. So, as you all know, there is a mission and then there are roles. Both of these things are pretty much long term. Right? I look after human resources, which is my long term responsibility. Right? And similarly, there is a mission in front of company, which is again a long term. Thank you so much. And then there are goals and then there are plans. What we actually did, that long term cycle, we actually shortened it and we made it as a weekly cycle. Right? You can imagine, you talk about 5-year long business planning and then 3-year business planning, then annual business plan, and then quarterly plan, and then monthly schedule. We actually compressed the whole thing into a weekly kind of schedule. And we said, one is you schedule, and second thing is you delegate. Right? And then that has to be, there has to be weekly to-do list. Believe me or not, thousands of people across the country, each one of them including me, we had a to-do list. We had a very simple to-do list. And there were three things on that to-do list. One, what am I going to do today or this week to make sure that I'm bringing orders to this company? Right? What am I going to do? Second, what am I going to do to make sure that we ship things out and we do our sales realization? And third, how am I going to do collect money from the marketplace? Very simple, very focused, right? Don't think about long-term plan and business strategy and customer segmentation and how we will position ourselves, which products are right and pricing strategy. Don't think anything about that. Focus on your booking. How do I increase my booking? How do I get booking today? How do I sell today? And how do I collect today? And that's where the entire organization, and we travel across the region 1 year later, and people used to still show their to-do list to us. Massive success, massive success. So, and then, post that, you know, essentially, we engaged a lot of high potential employees into driving some of the projects over there. Let me go back onto the earlier chart that we were talking about. We talked about focus. Engaging high pots was essentially done through a lot of projects. By every product line, by every customer segment, industry segment, or by your geography, we had project assigned to some of these high potential employees. And three high potential employees were selected, one who would monitor collections, one who would monitor sales, and one who would monitor your booking. And all of those people were our MBA graduates. We had hired them recently, 2 years, 3 years in the system, but they were heading this entire business across the country. So that's about the engaging high potential, and then reorganization. So business happens in two parts. A business essentially, we have a project business wherein the large projects, orders we win, and then we go on executing the project. Second is something called as MRO, which is maintenance repairs, which is essentially an operating expenses, which is essentially product sales, right? So we said in this particular time frame, we don't have luxury to win big projects because the business cycle is much longer. You will see sales realization after 18 months, 24 months. We don't have luxury to do that. We need more cash. We need more turnaround. We need a much shorter business cycle. What we actually did, the sales force across the country, we looked at the composition and we realized that 40-45% people essentially focus on project business, and 55% people, they focus on MRO business. And we went line by line, name by name, and we change that composition to 15% of them would focus on project and 85% of them would essentially focus on MRO business. And that was the biggest work that was done by the human resource team across the countries. And then we saw a quick turnaround. The year which was actually going down in May, June time frame, we turned around in a double-digit growth by September end. So that's the success story. So you know, if I really recap the whole thing, you know, what we talked about first, world around us is changing fairly fast and we are responsible for it. There is no point in blaming the external world for what's happening to you and things around you, number one. Number two, you look at your own business model, accept the reality and accept the fact, realize that we need to do something about it. And then get back into your organization, look at your essential construct of moral compass and productivity and sales your business results and being human, and then design your strategies around that. And I think you will be able to manage downturn much effectively. That's all from my side. If you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer those. I shouldn't be giving my opinion on something which I am not connected to, because neither I belong to startup nor I understand their strategy and what they really need to do. I will perhaps talk from my personal sense and what we do. So in Emerson, we actually plan. We have been doing MBA program for a long time, but last year, for whatever reason, we couldn't do. So we said we didn't go to campus. We didn't go and made any offers to the campus. We said we can't do. And then I think we did one or two, but not at the scale at which we used to do. So that's a better way of doing it, so that you don't really go on to the college and then get into a situation of taking those offers back. Having said that, there is also a lot of competition which is created. So if I look at from a campus perspective, there is a lot of competition we ourselves have created among those companies. So there's -1 day, 0 days, and first day and second day companies. So companies would want to go for a best talent. So it's competitive for them to reach on the campus on time, before time, whichever way possible, and roll out the offers. And then make sure that those people, the top talent, they get the top talent. And then it results into something like this. So that could be second challenge, that maybe the planning process is lacking. Why can't we be proactive with some of these companies? Why can't we have students to develop their choice beforehand, so there is no rush both ways when companies are on the campus? And third is obviously for the companies, they will need to really look into their future, what they will do, and be a little more planned in advance. So those could be two, three things. But I'm not an authority. This is what from my personal experience I could show.
Sir?
I can't see you. So I'll give you an example. You know, first you have to grow, right? Growth has to be there in mind. Once you think that I need to achieve growth, your focus from cutting number of jobs moves to eliminate redundancies within your organization. That first change has to happen, right? So I'm not getting into a matrix of reducing 5,000 people, but how can I eliminate some of the redundancies that I have? How can I eliminate some of the inefficiencies that I have in the system? That's number one. Number two, there are various ways and means to, you know, improve the path. You improve your productivity, you improve your quality, you actually, you know, you move into a better cost position. Right? So cost is a relative term. You know, one is the absolute cost, second is the relative cost. You always say value for money, right? So cost is relative, and there are a lot of ways you can find that there are holes from which you can actually generate more cash. The inefficiencies are making you pay more. In a project kind of environment, let's say, LDs, essentially a payment which is deducted or a penalty which is charged on you because of the delays. Now, if you improve your processes, you could avoid that. You collect more, you know, you have a better cash position, you avoid a lot of other injury. There are various means and ways you can cut the costs. And an example can be different in different industries. But human capital intensive industry, maybe that is the way to look at it.
But sir, when the company is in the downturn, how can it increase the production because the market is
there? I'm not saying production, I'm saying productivity. So there's a difference between the two. How quickly you respond, how quickly you generate the yield, that's different.
Sir, now you see many companies are forgetting their ethical values. Like if you take the example of Patanjali, they are telling in advertising that don't use Colgate, don't use Pepsodent, use the Kanti. So, how much this is, what if this type of things is correct?
Correct. There is always, I don't know about Patanjali's strategy. Frankly speaking, I can't comment on what they do is right or wrong. But
the
yes.
Same thing happened with Horlicks and Bonvita.
Pardon?
The same thing happened with Horlicks and Bonvita.
Yeah.
They start rivals.
The whole thing is about negativity. You know, for negativity is you are, you know, how should I really put it? I don't know, but the way I look at the whole branding strategy, it has to be always a healthy, competition. The way it should happen, the very fundamental principle of that is how my product is better than your product. You know, if it is positioned along this philosophy, you don't need to say that their product is bad. Correct. Yeah, I don't know, but I haven't seen any advertisement to that specifically say, because they have become very aggressive, and the Patanjali has picked up one very popular thing, that Swadeshi. You know, it really gives us a little more. So that I have seen them using that this is a rulers and now the industries and all of that. But I am not very sure whether they are using, they are naming a particular brand. I don't know whether they are doing that. If they are doing it, it's actually not good. My sense. Okay. Anything else?
No, sir.
Was it useful?
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for enlightening us with your words of wisdom. You shared your experience and knowledge and also told us about the things that have changed in this VUCA world. You also talked about the 6-step process to achieve our mission. We are very grateful to have you here, sir. We look forward for further more interactions on and off the dais. Thank you.
We are now request Professor D.S. Kadam, Director of Projects in Alumni Affairs, to present a memento to our guests.